avansezi, indiferent de ceea ce alegi să faci, indiferent de vârsta pe care o ai, indiferent de cine ești, care să te ajute să abordezi noi provocări, să progresezi zi de zi. Asistență pentru proiectele tale cele mai importante. Acces la finanțare și la rețelele necesare pentru consolidarea creșterii economice și crearea mai multor locuri de muncă. Transport și infrastructură modernă în regiunile și orașele României. Opțiuni mai ecologice care protejează mediul și oferă acces la energie mai curată. Formare și instruire personalizată pentru dezvoltarea competențelor și a capacității de inserție profesională și pentru a garanta că fiecare are o șansă de a avansa. Cercetare și inovare care să ofere noi tehnologii și servicii medicale mai bune. Uniunea Europeană investește în viitorul tău. În România și în fiecare țară din Uniune, rezultatele sunt vizibile. Cei care au beneficiat deja de acestea sunt cei mai în măsură să povestească. Povestea ta se scrie acum.
Society is complex. Our problems are very complex. Our answers will be complex, but we can only find those answers together with 500 million Europeans.
Let's work together. I'm here to learn from you. I'm looking forward to discuss with you. I would like to hear what you expect from the future of Europe and what you are expecting me to do for you.
Five years ago, it was hard to believe that we'll be on this stage together.
I'm here to listen to you very carefully, and I would like to hear about your opinion, how we have to develop the European Union. I'm ready to take your questions.
How can we make Europe more transparent?
We need more content, we need to talk, we need to listen. We need to listen to your concerns and change the system on the basis of your concerns.
De ajutor se poate dovedi utilă oricui pentru a-și continua dezvoltarea. Uniunea Europeană înseamnă oportunități, modalități concrete care să te ajute să avansezi, indiferent de ceea ce alegi să faci, indiferent de vârsta pe care o ai, indiferent de cine ești, care să te ajute să abordezi noi provocări, să progresezi zi de zi. Asistență pentru proiectele tale cele mai importante. Acces la finanțare și la rețelele necesare pentru consolidarea creșterii economice și crearea mai multor locuri de muncă. Transport și infrastructură modernă în regiunile și orașele României. Opțiuni mai ecologice care protejează mediul și oferă acces la energie mai curată. Formare și instruire personalizată pentru dezvoltarea competențelor și a capacității de inserție profesională și pentru a garanta că fiecare are o șansă de a avansa. Cercetare și inovare care să ofere noi tehnologii și servicii medicale mai bune. Uniunea Europeană investește în viitorul tău. În România și în fiecare țară din Uniune, rezultatele sunt vizibile. Cei care au beneficiat deja de acestea sunt cei mai în măsură să povestească. Povestea ta se scrie acum.
Society is complex. Our problems are very complex. Our answers will be complex, but we can only find those answers together with 500 million Europeans.
Let's work together. I'm here to learn from you. I'm looking forward to discuss with you. I would like to hear what you expect from the future of Europe and what you are expecting me to do for you.
Five years ago, it was hard to believe that we'll be on this stage together.
I'm here to listen to you very carefully, and I would like to hear about your opinion, how we have to develop the European Union. I'm ready to take your questions.
How can we make Europe more transparent?
We need more content, we need to talk, we need to listen. We need to listen to your concerns and change the system on the basis of your concern.
Ajutor se poate dovedi utilă oricui pentru a-și continua dezvoltarea. Uniunea Europeană înseamnă oportunități, modalități concrete care să te ajute să avansezi, indiferent de ceea ce alegi să faci, indiferent de vârsta pe care o ai, indiferent de cine ești, care să te ajute să abordezi noi provocări, să progresezi zi de zi. Asistență pentru proiectele tale cele mai importante. Acces la finanțare și la rețelele necesare pentru consolidarea creșterii economice și crearea mai multor locuri de muncă. Transport și infrastructură modernă în regiunile și orașele României. Opțiuni mai ecologice care protejează mediul și oferă acces la energie mai curată. Formare și instruire personalizată pentru dezvoltarea competențelor și a capacității de inserție profesională și pentru a garanta că fiecare are o șansă de a avansa. Cercetare și inovare care să ofere noi tehnologii și servicii medicale mai bune. Uniunea Europeană investește în viitorul tău. În România și în fiecare țară din Uniune, rezultatele sunt vizibile. Cei care au beneficiat deja de acestea sunt cei mai în măsură să povestească. Povestea ta se scrie acum.
Bună ziua tuturor. Numele meu e Tudor Mușat.
Everybody, I'm Tudor Mușat and I'm a journalist. Thank you very much for showing up here, and I'm very happy to welcome you to the Citizens' Dialogue of the European Commission in charge with employment, social affairs, skills and labor mobility. I would also like to thank the University in Iași that is our host today. Now, a few words before actually starting the Citizens' Dialogue of today, so that we have an animated discussion and a production discussion. I'm very happy to have the opportunity to witness. It's a second time in 6 months to do that. It's very interesting for me as a journalist and as a representative of civil society to hear from a high-rank European official ideas and I also have to have a very dynamic exchange of ideas, of course, on condition that you make your voices heard. You can do that by using the microphones, the mobile microphones that will be distributed in the room. And please raise your hands as high as possible if you want to ask a question. And then I would like to ask you that after you ask the question, please let go of the microphone so that other people are able to pick it up and ask their questions. You can also, in case in which there is no time now for everybody who wishes to ask questions to do so today, please ask your questions on the social media networks. You know the hashtag. You also find there today's dialogue, citizens' dialogue. At a certain point in time, after the European Commissioner steps on the stage, I would ask a question, and you will have the opportunity to use electronic vote system, the password. So after each J, it's a small L and not a capital I. So please remember this. It's very important when you use the password. I do hope to have a productive and interesting discussion when the European Commissioner steps on the stage, onto the stage. The entire conversation will take place in English. So if you need from then on to use the simultaneous interpretation equipment, we will start very soon. I do hope you will have a lot of questions to ask. It is not a matter of a speech on a spoken up on a stage, but a dynamic dialogue with even from the balcony, of course. So thank you very much once again. And let's start.
So, ladies and gentlemen, once again, welcome. I'll give you the European Commissioner for Employment, Social Affairs, Skills and Labor Mobility, Mrs. Marianne Thyssen. Welcome, Mrs. Thyssen. And once again, quick words about how to vote on slide.do platform. You'll have the details right now. Just before the commissioner addresses her first words, I will invite you to ask the question, which is, do you feel your voice is heard, of course, in what concerns the European Union and European Union institutions? And possible responses are yes, no, I don't know. So the voting process has started. All right. And right before starting our actual dialogue with you, the audience, I will invite Commissioner Thyssen to just address a few words and just give us, please, your vision about this type of dialogue with the European Union citizens.
Buena ziva! Eu sunt Marianne Thyssen, Commissar European, and now you think that I will continue in Romanian language, but unfortunately this is impossible for me, so I'll have to do it in English. But I am glad to hear that you are all perfectly English-speaking young people, so this gives me a little bit more comfort. As the moderator told you, I am the Commissioner for Employment, Social Affairs, Labour Mobility and Skills, and my mission is to make sure that Europe is indeed social, that we make the lives of all Europeans better, and that our economies are strong enough to ensure prosperity and well-being. People is what Europe is about. That is a sentence I often use, and social Europe is, of course, about putting people first. It's also about preparing today for the world of tomorrow, tapping into the opportunities it offers and being ready for the challenges it faces. These issues affect each and every one of us. This is why today's discussion is very important. I want to hear about your expectations, about your experiences, about your expectations from Social Europe also. And I'm glad to have this debate here in Romania to discuss how we can best deliver real benefits for real people. No one must be left behind or pushed aside. The Commission published, some of you might know, the Commission published a white paper on the future of Europe in March to launch the debate about our common future. And in his State of the Union speech in September the 13th, our President of the European Commission, President Jean-Claude Juncker, made it very clear that Europe is a union of equals, that there cannot be second-class Europeans. And that extends from our economic and monetary union to our common external borders or Schengen area. But let me explain you briefly how this is translated into practice for the Commission in the social files. In the Commission, we believe it is about bringing our societies and our member states closer to each other, making them stronger. And this is essentially what we strive for with our initiative of a European pillar of social rights. It is a convergence instrument. It is a compass. It is an instrument, a framework that we will use as our compass to go for more convergence, for equal opportunities, for fair labor markets and social systems, and for opportunities for education and training for everybody. The pillar affects, let us say, all aspects of life. First, in the workplace. What we are saying is that workers in Europe have to get the same pay for the same work in the same place, so that the Romanian worker posted to Germany gets the same pay as his German colleague working there. We are working very hard to make this happen. And second, it's also about equality of opportunities. We need to meet the challenges posed by technology and new business models. You can use your iPhone and you can use it to order a taxi or to order a meal or even a babysitter, but the question that raises is, what about the people who deliver the services? What does this mean for social protection? And what does this mean for their pension and their health insurance? Also, with 70 million people in Europe lacking basic skills, literacy, numeracy, digital skills, the question is how we can invest better to empower all those people to take up the opportunities of the new world of work and avoid low quality dead end jobs. And third, in the year 2017, 10 years after the accession of Romania, and congratulations for that, but still in the year 2017, we are fighting everywhere in Europe, fighting for equality between men and women. No woman should be forced to choose between a family and a career. And all men should have the right, should have also the opportunity, the real opportunity, to take a leave, to be there with their families when they need them. But how can we make this a reality in our workplaces and also at home? And last but not least, we have equality between generations. Youth unemployment is my first priority when I started as commissioner in 2014. It was really the first priority of this commission. Employment, specifically youth employment. And our youth guarantee, supported by the Youth Employment Initiative, a dedicated fund, has brought about positive change in Romania, also elsewhere. But how can we make sure that those initiatives reach also the young people facing the most difficulties, or that it leads to quality opportunities for our young people? These are just a few examples of what we are doing, but today, of course, it is about your opinions, it is about your questions, it is about your hope and your dreams. And I will answer to your questions as best as I can. It is a duty of us to think together how we can shape our future. We have a lot of challenges: globalization, demographic aging, digitalization. This brings a lot of opportunities, but also challenges. And I am convinced, and I hope you share that with me, that we are capable of building a bright future, but we have to not to ignore the challenges, we have to face them, and we have together built the institutions and the way of living and working together to find a society, to build a society where we do not leave anybody behind. This is a real challenge, but I'm convinced that together we will make it. And I'm now very curious to hear about your questions and your expectations. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Commissioner Thijssen. Waiting for the audience to warm up, I'll start myself with a question. Given the young audience present here, there's a whole public talk in Romania about how to match the needs in terms of workforce of the companies, of the institutions, with what the schools and universities are able to provide to this labor market. And we seem to not be able to find the answer so far. Any idea of how could we match these two expectations, let's say?
Well, this is really a good question, and I just mentioned our initiative on a European pillar of social rights, and on top of it we have skills, education, training, lifelong learning, apprenticeship, dual learning, and all this kind of beautiful things of which we know that we have to invest in it. The world, the economy is changing. And what we see is that with the digital era, we can say, that people need more digital skills, but also other skills. And if we look at the future skills needs, we don't know exactly what we will need because it's changing so fastly, but we know that there will be changes, and we know that the requirements for people to find a place on the labor market, to take up the employment that's available, that the skills level, the demand, the requests will be higher. So education is really very important. And what can we do? Well, we developed already. We were not waiting for the social pillar or the pillar of social rights. We launched already a skills strategy. Skills strategy, first of all, to make sure that the lowest skilled people, those who have most difficulties to find a job or to keep their job, that we can upskill them. We made an agreement with member states. They committed themselves to come with reform programs to give a second chance to adults that have only low skills attainments. And we are also looking at other levels, because it's not just at the lower end, but also at the upper end. And therefore, I am so happy and so proud that I can that we have this citizens' dialogue here at a bright university, because we also have to look at the curricula of university students. Are they relevant for the labor market? Because this is very important to find a job and to bridge the step from education to the job market. It is what is relevant, what is really needed in the economy. We have to look at that. We have to go for more intelligence on that field. This is something that we cannot do alone. And therefore, we started what we call sectoral blueprints. We bring across Europe people together on a sectoral base, for instance, around automotive, around shipping, around in the construction sector, in the additive manufacturing sector, and so on. We bring people together from the educational field, academics, people from the enterprises, people that are responsible to finance education, authorities, and so on, to talk together and to look together what we think will be the needs for the near future, and to bring this developments and this knowledge to the education institutes. But skills is of an utmost importance. It's skills, skills, skills. And we know also that in the future, if we look at how the society will look for the next, let me say, next 20, 25, 30 years, that it will be different from the time of, let me say, my parents. At that time, you started in a job and you stayed in that job. Maybe you changed once in your life, but that was it. And now we are sure that young people of today, they will have more transitions in their working life. So to have good basic skills, to be adaptable, to be able to learn, to upskill during your career, also that is very important, and that is why fields on which together with member states, we are developing policies.
Do you feel that more should be done at the level of the state policies, for example, or even at the local level of university policies, or I don't know, maybe even company policies of hiring and recruiting and starting training programs for students? Whose job is it to push it forward?
Well, it is indeed the job of member states, of the countries, of local levels, of universities, of all those involved. Also, employers have a task here. Indeed, you rightly mentioned them. Because we at European level, we see what's going on. We can stimulate member states and authorities to do the right thing. But we are not the ones who are developing the curricula. We are not the ones who are organizing or directly financing education systems. So this is in the hands of member states. What we do is ask those who have the competence on this field to work together, to learn from each other, to develop in the right direction. So yes, it has to be done in member states. It has to be done at universities. And you mentioned employers, and this is very important because they also have a task. And we are big believers in the European Commission. I am really a believer of the added value of work-based learning, to have the possibility to practice already when you are a student, to go for an internship or a traineeship in an enterprise. This is really of a high added value. And we see, if we look at the results, that this is helping to build the bridge from education to the real job market. So also employers, we invite them to offer places for apprenticeships, to offer places for traineeships for young people. And of course, we want them to offer good quality places. It's not just to keep them busy or to use them a little bit. No, it must be quality offers. And therefore, we also developed a quality framework for traineeship, a quality framework that is our last product, let me say, quality product for apprenticeship, to make sure that there is a learning path, that there are mentors, and that young people are really learning in that phase in the enterprises.
Thank you. Please feel free to raise your hand, as we agreed, in order to have your voice heard here in the debate. Meanwhile, while you are preparing your questions, there's a question coming from Slido, the platform, and the question goes like, what's the key to unite people disregarding social status and ethnicity to have a unite Europe without having situations like Catalonia or Scotland? So it's very connected to what happens right as we speak.
Well, a united Europe is of course important, but how member states organize themselves internally, that's of course in the hands of the member states. I mean, if there is a choice in a member state to have a federal system with regions with huge autonomy and their own competences in certain fields, or whether there is a more centralized stage. This is something that has to be decided within member states. But what I say to people who are really like Catalonia, for instance, because that's now a very concrete issue. What we say in European Commission, and that's my conviction also, this is a problem, an issue that has to be solved in Spain. Many people say now European Commission should be there to play the role as a broker, a mediator. What we say is, please talk with each other. This is about your state structure. This is about your legal framework. This is about your constitutions. What can you do? What can't you do? If you want another legal framework, another constitution, how can you change it? This is according to national rules. So I hope they find a peaceful solution in Spain and that everybody calms a little bit and that they really talk to each other and that they play by the rules, because of course playing by the rules and respect your constitution is very important, but you also must have occasions when you change the rules, but then you also have procedures and you have to follow the procedures. On the other hand, what I think also when I look at Catalonia, I think Catalonia, it's not, well, people in Catalonia, they are not discriminated. They are not worse off than other Spaniards. There is equal treatment in Spain, so it's really something that they have to organize together internally. And further, I hope that in Spain, just like in all the other countries, we look forward to the real economic and social problems we have to solve, because there are many. The economy is changing, digitalization, globalization, and what we need is, I think that's very important for Europe, and there Europe has an added value to bring, is that we look together at the problems we face together. And I'm sure that if we look at globalization and digitalization, there are many questions about what is the impact of that on our society, on the way we live together, on the values according to which we organized our labor market, our social security system, our society. And what we must ensure is that we can keep those values, I would say, alive and kicking. We have to make sure that we have a voice on the global scene to ensure that we can still decide on the way we live and the way we work according to the values and the preferences we share in Europe. And this is the most important challenge for all the member states, even if you see some debates about regionalism and certain regions that want more powers. Let's keep that internally for the member states themselves.
Thank you. We'll have a first question coming from there, please.
Hello. I will try to put some context first in my question. For example, I've changed 6 jobs in less than 2 years, and from my experience, only one employer respected the contract. Here in Romania, we have this problem with employers that don't respect the contract, meaning, for example, the employee gets in the contract a sum of money, but he's paid more than what says in the contract, and the employer doesn't pay the right taxes. They pay the percentage of the taxes. They just, how we say in Romania, we are in a gray area. They just pay the taxes for the minimum wage, but the worker doesn't get the minimum wage. So that affects his pension. And in case of the woman, it affects the sum of money that she will get from the state when she's on maternal leave. And also what happens, there's this problem that, for example, in the contract, you get a position working in an office, but actually work in the warehouse. And I think these are some three main problem in the work labor in Romania. And I think that before making new policies, we should make sure that the state or the employers respect this minimal law, like respect this minimal rights of the employers. I filed some complaints, but I filed 2 complaints, but the answer that I get from the authorities wasn't satisfactory, in my opinion. So how can we not say convince the state, but also the employers to respect the law. Because if you go in, and we spend most of our time working 8 hours a day. Most of our free time, well, actually not our free time, we spend working. So what happens in a job affects our personal life also. So how can we just force the employees to respect the contract that they sign?
They respect the law,
and
after
also
all, and
to make
and
sure
the
that
contract.
the institution that have to make sure that these laws are respected do their job properly.
Mm-hmm. All right, thank you.
Yeah, thank you for this question. Well, you're right. If this happens, you are rightly points to this problem, because having legislation in place is one thing, but having it implemented on the ground is another thing. And of course, if legislation is not respected, then you can ask yourself, yeah, well, why do we have it for? I think this is a matter of inspection and of capacity of inspectorates who have to watch what's going on and to listen when there are problems, to act or to react. Depending on the situation, not directly to say we are going to punish everybody who's not respecting the law, but at least to give stimulants, to incentivize them to do so. So to point, to explain what are the obligations in the first place, but if then they are not respected, yeah, to act. I think this is what inspections and authorities should do. So I think this is a matter of responsibility of the Romanian state. Inspection of legislation, also in labor law, it's always competence of member states. From the European Union out, we cannot come to Romania and inspect ourselves. This is a clear distribution of competences. Inspection is in the member state itself. So I think here, if this is happening, if your situation is not exceptional, if this is really happening on many more places, then I think that there is a problem with the inspectorate and with the institutions. So laws must be, well, everybody must play by the rules, let me say. The first problem is, of course, with the employer that does not respect the rules. But if this is the case, then you need authorities that make them respect it. I cannot say more on this.
Thank you. Please raise your hand firmly in order to be seen. Yes, please. And okay.
So there are some employers in Romania who work at multinational companies, for example, Amazon. Why they get less than in other countries? I refer to Spain. At salaries, I don't know.
So they are paid less, you say,
yes,
because they work here?
Yes.
All right.
Salaries, that's, of course, I know there is a debate that what we say, what the Commission position is, that we need more convergence, more equality. We have no second-class workers and first-class workers and so on. So for posting workers, where we really have this labor mobility, there we can intervene, and we have European rules, because it is about cross-border situations. People are moving from one member state to another. When it is work provided in the member state where you live and work, the salaries in each member state, this is something that is in the hands of the authorities of member states. Authorities, then I say it's possible that you have law about the salaries, but most of the time it is something that is agreed upon among social partners, employers' representatives and trade union representatives. So if they come to different agreements in different member states, yes, then you have a difference. And you can ask questions why for the same job and the same work the salary is different, but this is, you can also have the same within one member state if the agreements are at a different level. Of course, how are wages, how you can define what is a decent wage or a normal wage? It depends often not only on the enterprise itself, but also on the environment around, the living standard, the infrastructure, the environment in which enterprises invest and develop their activities. So it's a rather complex environment. But this is something that is in the hands of social partners, first place social partners and member states.
Thank you. So we're waiting for more questions regarding jobs, careers, social protection, work mobility. Meanwhile, since it's related to salaries, I will ask you, given one of the current challenges, and this is innovation, atypical and flexible jobs, what are the challenges here and what type of protection should cover people working in some sort of new formats of jobs, like working from home, like working part-time and everything?
Yeah. Or for a platform like Amazon you mentioned. I just wanted to add also, of course, what we care about, and this is what we are looking at European level, is to see how these new forms of work, which kind of employment it is producing, and whether people that work for platforms or in other new situations, let me see, that we have not seen so much before, whether they are covered by the legislation that is in place in a member state, or whether they have access to social security protection. Are they allowed? Are they obliged? Can they contribute to a system to build up a pension system, to build up an health insurance scheme, just like other workers do, or under which conditions this should happen? Because now we have the risk that we see new forms of employment that are not covered by all the, let me call it, old social security and labor law institutions. Sometimes we do not know, are we talking about a self-employed, an independent worker, or is it an employee or a worker that works for another employer? It's not always clear. When you say, I am freelance, yeah, what does it mean? Do you have to live with the obligations of an employer or an independent worker? Or are you working for a boss, Amazon, or something else? Is a platform an employer or is it just a platform? This is something we are reflecting on. We are now consulting social partners about their vision at European level. We ask the trade unions and the employers organizations, also the organizations that represent small and medium-sized enterprises, what their reflections are upon this. And we are looking how we can develop also European legislation to make sure that nobody is left behind. Because we don't want a duality on the labor market with contracts, let me say, old style jobs, the ones we have known since a long time, where we have legislation in place to protect people, and other jobs where people are totally unprotected. So we look how, for instance, we can put minimum levels of protection. Minimum levels of protection, for instance, for people with contracts, what we call zero-hour contracts, on-call contracts. How can people be sure that they have at least a couple of days a week they can work? How do they have to be transformed? What about the... How to be sure what are the rights and the obligations of the one and the other? That's one thing. And how to give them access to social protection systems and to services, social services that are available for people. This is a big challenge. But we are not ignoring it. It is a new field of work. And we are reflecting with all the member states together and at this moment also with social partners to see whether we can develop European legislation. Anyway, if social partners tell us that they don't want to negotiate to come to autonomous agreements in these fields to give a direction in which we can go, then we will come up with proposals ourselves in the spring of next year.
So those young people here will have to probably support like maybe two pensioners, each of them, in the near future. There's another huge public discussion here in Romania, for example. And what has to be done
in this respect, given the demographic challenge this time, in order for them to know how and who will pay their pensions to?
Very important question. And one thing is clear, and let's be happy about that. We know what the problem is, because people are born, and we see we can now predict very clearly what the demographic evolution is for the coming years. And we know that there are fewer people in the active age cohorts. Let me say that the relationship is changing. We have now 1 in 4 active people, 1 pensioned retired people for active people. And in the future, everywhere in Europe, by 2060, the figure will be 1 to 2. So it means that we have to look how we are going to finance the pensions of the future and also your pensions. How we are going to prevent that you have really, to contribute more, to work longer, and to receive less in the future. So we have to look how to finance pensions. What we see is that people live longer than in the past, but in many member states, we still have retirement ages like in the past. So we have to raise retirement ages, and this is what we advise member states to do. And in many member states, in all member states, the debate took place, or the debate is going on raising the retirement age, because we will have to work longer if we live longer. We cannot say we go to university until we are 25 years old, we start working, and at 55 or 60 years old, we stop, and we live among 85, like what is the life expectation in some member states. So we have to work longer, and we have to look at means to finance. Probably not only finance social security and pensions by contributions from people at work, but also look for other sources to make sure that there is enough pension, that the pension is not only sustainable, that we can pay the system, but that it's also adequate, that the level of the pension is high enough to have a dignified life. We have to look how to develop a second pillar and a certain pillar, the occupational pensions, not only the legal pension scheme, because it will probably not high enough to have a dignified life. So we must invite people to build also pensions to have to save and to build also upon their own pension scheme in a second pillar and a third pillar. So a lot is going on here, but it's very important, not only for those who will have pensions soon, but also for young people that will have more burden. And if you allow me to add another element on this, if in Europe we say to member states that they must be careful with their debt, that you need sound public finances, it's also with an eye on this pension problem. Because if you raise debt, it means that you also raise the interest rates you have to pay. And this is also for the next generation. Making debt now is having obligations for the next generation, because once things have to be paid. So knowing that the burden for the pensions will be already higher in the future, it means that you cannot also make the burden bigger side of the public finances. So we have to watch and to take the right decisions to make sure that the stones that you accept in your backpack as young people are not too heavy. There must be intergenerational solidarity, and we must organize the system in such a way that we can keep the solidarity.
Thank you. Waiting for more questions. All right, please, sir. And then you. I've seen you. Okay.
Well, in September 13, Jean-Claude Juncker, in his speech about the state of the European Union, talking about the future, he said that a man, two men, working in the same company, having the same job, doing in the same place, must be paid equally. This is one. And the second, talking about consumers, first class in the west of Europe, second class in the east of Europe, about the quality, different quality, the same product, the same brand, the same company. How can you solve these two problems? Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much also for this question. First, on workers that are sent by their employer to another member state, there we have proposals that we are discussing now in the Council of Ministers and in the European Parliament. Proposals just to make happen what Jean-Claude Juncker said. When people work alongside each other, they do the same job in the same place, then we want that posted workers who come from another member state, that they have the same salary as the local workers. And very concretely, this means that all the elements of remuneration of the salary that are in a member state obligatory for the local workers, they must become obligatory also to be paid to the posted workers. So we have a proposal, we are discussing this, and I hope we can come to an agreement in the European Council, in the Council of Ministers still this month, end of October, and that the Parliament votes the report they have to prepare on this also in October. They will vote next week, and we have a Council of Ministers within 2 weeks, and then we can have the negotiations between all those institutions. But this is a very important part of our policy to ensure that workers are paid the same salary. It's very important to build a bridge between East and West, and this is what our president mentioned when he said, when we talk about East and Western Europe, and I don't like this because for me, Europe is one Europe, and we have 27, 28, and in the future, probably 27 member states. We are all member states. There are no new member states and old member states and East and South and North and West. We are all equal, and we have to develop, and we are doing these policies to make that really happen. Then on the consumers, there we also discovered, let me say, a problem, because it was announced that that sometimes products don't have the same quality. Let me say, you have one product that is in the shops available under the same brand, and the quality differs. So this is, of course, a responsibility in the first place of enterprises. We are not saying that what exactly must be if you have a pot of jam. Yeah, what must be in the jam? Yes, of course, it must be fruit and sugar. And there we have some regulation, and it's harmonized across Europe. But when there is more sugar or less sugar in the pot, that depends on what the enterprises decide to do. But I can see the problem when people in certain member states see that the products that they have on the shelf in the shops are of a lower quality under the same brand name. So we are looking now in Europe, in the European institutions, what we can do about this. It's not very clear. We cannot legislate everything, but we look what we can do, because that was what Jean-Claude Juncker meant. We don't want first-class consumers and second-class consumers. And even if this is not meant like this by those entrepreneurs or by those producers, because I can tell you, I'm Belgian. I'm from Belgium. And my mother was Dutch. So I went often to my family in Holland years ago when I was a child. And I discovered at that time also that some products tasted different in Holland than in Belgium, and they were sold under the same brand. So it's not always about second class and first class. Sometimes it is about a difference in taste. But we are looking at it, because we don't want people to have the feeling that they are treated as second class. This is something that we cannot have. So we are looking into that dossier also.
The gentleman over there, okay.
I just wanted to ask you, is there any common strategy at EU level in order to reduce informal employment? And what do you think about the recent political measure in Romania to impose full-time taxes for part-time jobs in terms of impact on reducing uninformal employment? I mean, can this measure reduce informal employment or encourage it?
Thank you.
Well, informal work, it's a nice word to say, yeah, it's not declared. So we had already an issue on not respecting the rules. I think informal work, in the end, it's not respecting the rules. Otherwise, it would be formal work. So we have a platform against undeclared work in Europe, where we have people from inspections and labor institutions from all the member states together to have an exchange of view how to tackle it and how to bring informal into formal. Because if people have a formal job, they are, of course, better off, because then first society is better off because they pay taxes on their income, but they also are covered by social security and labor law institutions, and if it's informal, you are not covered. So there we have a platform to have an exchange of view, what we can do in every member state to make it to have more formal work and not be happy just with informal work. And then on the taxes on part-time work and full-time work, I'm afraid I do not have enough information to really judge upon it. But what I can tell you is that what we see in the labor market is more precarious work situations. Because we come from the economic and financial crisis, it was not the best period. Now we can say we turn a page, but we see still on the labor market that we have many precarious contracts for people. And this can be temporary contracts, partial, part-time contracts, or other kind of contracts. Part-time work, it's a good thing. It's better to have a part-time job than to have no job. If part-time is a choice of somebody, because it can also help certain people to combine private life with the job and so on, if it's a free choice, it's also a good thing. But we see that in many cases it's not voluntary. It is because there is nothing else. And if you then stick in this kind of jobs, we stimulate member states to stimulate going from part-time to full-time, if this is possible. Member states can give incentives to go from part-time to full-time. They can do that also with tax elements, but how exactly here in Romania it works, I do not have enough information to give a judgment on this.
All right, thank you. Over there, please.
Hello, I have a question about employers. We agree that in Romania, in our country, the first question that the presenter asked, the education system does not give the necessary skills for people to get a job, and that's why they don't realize that in the first months. Now, the employers want to invest in them and send them to trainings, but the problem is that the law does not protect them. If an employer makes an investigation and invests in someone, like in 10 people, only to get 2 working men out of those 10 people, that was not okay because the education...
So you feel that the business environment should do the work of the academic environment?
That's what they does, but they do not have to do the work of academic environment, and they are not protected because the law doesn't offer them the way to get back the money that they invested training those people. And that stops the training of young people for them to learn new skills.
Thank you. It's basically a risk not covered by anyone in what concerns the company.
Yeah, I see.
And I want to know if the European Union has a plan for that, to split the costs of that training or to protect the companies giving these trainings. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah, that's... we cannot decide on everything in Europe, as you know, but here, I think first, what I want to say on this is first, when you have on-the-job training, this is already a good thing, because as I said, apprentices, dual learning, job, work-based learning, we know that a difficult moment in young people's life, the transition from school to a job, to the first job, is very difficult. And those who have had the occasion to be in a work-based learning situation, their chance is much better. So we stimulate that. Question is, how? What do member states have to do? We know that this is, it is belonging to the culture of education in certain member states, like Germany. We also have it in Switzerland, in Austria, in Denmark. They have a culture of apprenticeships and dual learning. And they have an institutional organization that they accept. But what we also see there, when this kind of on-the-job training or apprenticeships is generalized, then employers, they invest. They have a risk, of course, because you cannot oblige the people to stay working for you and your company. But they know that if they lose one of their trainees, let me say later on, that they will gain another one that has gone through the same path in another enterprise. So they are motivated to continue to invest. That's what I learned from German employers. If, of course, you start with the development of these systems, because in many member states it's not as well developed as in Germany, Austria, and Denmark, then, yeah, you have to start with it. So I think maybe member states, the states, or local authorities could give an incentive to the employers, but this is up to decisions of the member states. Can we ask that employers are totally paid for it? I think when the apprentices or the trainees are working there, it's also, how can I say, an opportunity for the employers, because often they invest in people that will stay in that workplace. So it's trainee, yes, but also prepare often your own workers of the future. So I think it is a real investment. You cannot just say it has to be paid by everybody else. What is important, I think, to develop this is that there is a good administrative framework, that everybody knows exactly what are my rights, what are my obligations, am I sure that when I go on this path that I have a certificate afterward, that the skills I obtained, that I learned in the enterprise, are there is a certification that so that I can document the skills and the competences I learned there. I think this is very important. The distribution of the financial burden, I think this has to be discussed at local level or at the country level. But it's not just about the financial burden. I think it's more a matter of creating a culture that people trust more in this system. And when the culture is widely spread, it takes some time, then I'm sure that it is worth also for employers to invest in it.
Thank you. One more question from here. Please.
Firstly, I want to say that I'm really glad to have the opportunity to participate in such a debate regarding a topic that I'm really interested in, which is youth employment. And regarding his question of youth employment and traineeship and internships, I want to ask you, how can we as young people mobilize the universities, the academic entities, and the private and public institutes in order to create this, in order to facilitate young people the insertion on the labor market? Yes. And before you answer, I want to create a context for you. A group of young people, an informal group of young people formed by 34 NGOs that are working for the candidacy of Iași to the National Youth Capital, tried to have a meeting with the universities and with the private companies in order to raise this topic. And of course the universities accepted this need of young people to have relevant practice or relevant relevant practical skills, to learn these skills during university so that they can adapt more easily for the jobs. But there wasn't a clear, the university didn't assume something very specific or very clear. And yesterday we had a meeting with the private companies, and only 9 answered the invitation, and they agreed that they do want to make this kind of partnerships. And my question for you is, we had these meetings, and we want to gather universities and the private space, the private companies in the same space. How can we mobilize them in order to really make them assume, to assume these partnerships? And some of the faculties have these partnerships, like, and it's really nice, but some of them don't. And it's not about only the private companies, it's about public institutions, because Yash doesn't have yet a private space. You can learn, you can practice all you learn in faculties. So how can we as young people mobilize public institutions and private companies and university as well, mm-hmm. in order to make an agreement or something, a general agreement that can go for every faculties in order to facilitate young people relevant practice for their theoretical.
In order to benefit both sides.
Exactly, okay. Exactly.
Thank you.
Well, first of all, congratulations with your initiative. I think you are acting very well, and you are on a good way to achieve your goal. Talk with them and try to convince them. You cannot impose your wish, and we cannot do that either, but we stimulate education and enterprise partnership. If you want to develop dual learning, work-based learning, if you want to have a good idea of the needs of the future, which kind of skills we need, and not only which kind of skills, but how do we learn the skills, because it's not just the content of the skills, let me say, and the competences, it's also the way of learning that is changing. You need both sides, and bring them together is absolutely, I think, we cannot say it's what we want to have, but it's almost necessary. So what you do, you talk with the one, you talk with the other. You know that there are faculties here at university who already developed it, and I had an exchange of view, a nice talk with the rector of this university, and she was talking about this. So I think this university is really already a good example on this. So continue with your talks and convince them. I saw you asking the question. You are a very convincing young lady. So with your friends together, keep talking, and I'm sure that you will achieve your goal.
All right, thank you. Please, over there. Okay.
Every state of Europe insists on education, right? And Romania has a lot of students that study hard and become real specialists on their area of activity. So, what guarantees do you have that we will have a job after graduation? 'Cause we also could, let's say, could do some lower work and earn the same amount of money. So, what are the promises on this topic of the Europe, let's say?
Mm-hmm. Well,
thank you. There's a tough one.
It's good that many Romanians, as you say, study very hard, because I think I said it already, skills. It's very important, because if we look at the future, we see that people that will have most difficulties on the labor market in the future to find a job, to keep their job, are low-skilled people. So having skills and having a basis to upskill and reskill later in your life, that is of an utmost importance. So the first step is there. Then, of course, the second question is, are the jobs available? And therefore, I can tell you that Europe is working very hard. This commission started with a mission, with a clear mission. We said we can say that we turn a page. The hardest part of the financial and economic crisis is behind us, and now we turn the page and we go back to more convergence and upward convergence. We want a better situation for all people. And what do we have to do for that? First of all, jobs, jobs, jobs. So our mission, our mandate, the way our mission was formulated is we go for jobs, growth, democratic change, and fairness. That is really clear. And all the commissioners, I'm here as the Commissioner for Employment and Social Affairs and Skills, but we have other commissions with other responsibilities or competences, and all together we work to create the best possible environment to have innovation, to have a good investment climate. We stimulate investment also with our Juncker investment plan, with some money from the European budget. We put a lever under private finance to make it attractive to invest in real economy, to have innovation, and to create jobs, high-level jobs, where we need highly skilled people that can have a good quality job and a good salary and a nice family. So that is why we are working for what we are working for. Of course, we do not create the jobs. This is the enterprises. So we are very happy to see now, after 3 years, that we have 235 million people at work. In Europe, we never had so many people at work. Growth is coming back everywhere in Europe for the first time this year in all the member states. In Romania, we see that the growth is even the highest at the highest level. You have more than 4% growth. This is really amazing. Your employment rate is lower than the average of European Union, but it's also everywhere in Europe, the unemployment rate is going down, employment rate is going up, so we are going in the right directions, but we have to continue with this. And then it's up to enterprises to invest, private people with money to invest, to really make it happen in the real economy. But we do what we can. The most important part of the mission we started our mandate with was jobs, growth, democratic change, and we see that it's paying off already. So we hope that there will be many jobs available when you finish your studies, that you find something that you like and that helps you to earn a good living standard.
Thank you. Puteți, bineînțeles, pune întrebări și în limba română. E de la sine înțeles.
You can also ask questions in Romanian, because there is simultaneous interpretation available.
You want to ask a question? All right, we have a member of parliament here, please. And then we'll get back to you, all right?
Okay. First of all, thank you for being here. Welcome to Iași. It's an honor to have you here. We rarely have people travel to Digital Europe, as we call it here. As you know, we're 20 kilometers away from the border of Europe. And for the people here who don't know me, sunt deputatul vostru, sunt de la USR. I'm a member of parliament from USR. And my question to you is this. Are you coordinating efforts for employment with efforts for infrastructure? Because what we know here in Iași is that without roads, without railways, without bridges, without the physical infrastructures, employers will not come here because they cannot transport their products. So our skilled people, our smart, talented people that we have here will go away. They will go to Western Europe, they'll go to America. And so efforts for employment have to be coordinated with other types of efforts. And we need Europe's help, not just for, say, planning, because we see master plan after master plan, and we know what needs to be done. But we need help for implementation, we need help for financing, we need help for the reduction of corruption that prevents our development. I'm wondering how your department cooperates with other departments, especially infrastructure. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much for this question. You're totally right. We need to work on all fronts. We need to work on human capital development, and that is very important, but we also need infrastructure, and we need enterprises that invest. So when I was telling the young people here that with all the commissioners together, with the Commission, with our European institutions, we work on creating a better environment, it is also about its legal environment, its an economic environment, but it's also about infrastructure. And as far as concerns infrastructure, we have plans on transport to connect member states better. That's under the responsibility of my colleague Violeta Bulc, Commissioner for Transport. And Europe is investing a lot in those projects, especially in missing links and things that go cross-border. We have 9 special corridors in Europe that we are really pushing very hard. But also in general, there is the cohesion funds and structural funds in general that help member states with investment also in, let me call it, the hardware. And we have to work on both fronts. So we continue with that. We have now a multi-annual financial framework that is coming to an end in 2020. We are already reflecting on the future, and I'm sure that we will continue on both strands. It's about infrastructure, but also, let's not forget, human capital development. And since we are here at university, and since in my portfolio is also skills, I was stressing that most, but we don't forget the other.
Thank you. Please.
We were talking about skills, and I wanted to ask you what skills should a worker at the European Union institution should have? For example, a worker at a secretary, for example.
Well, what kind of skills to work for the European Union? European Union is, let me say, a public authority. It's an administration. The same skills as you need in Romania. And probably some extra language skills, it always helps. But administrative work in Europe is the same as administrative work here in the town, in the national parliament, in an enterprise. I think good skills, it depends on what you want to do. Huh? If you want to be a good secretary, I think the skills you need to be a good secretary in Romania are not different from what you need to be a good secretary at European level. If you want to be a lawyer in the European institutions, first become a good lawyer here in Romania, and then you see what you can do, what you have to know extra on European law, for instance, to do the right job or the job you want in Europe. But I think there are not that much differences. Of course, as I think it's always also the case here in Romania, we want professional people. It means that there are exams you have to pass, and you can look at our websites what exactly are the skills that you need to participate in those exams. And then it's a matter of studying and participating and try to become a member of this staff.
I think the real question is what other skills other than those professional skills are required, because you were talking in the beginning about the base that every people in the entering the workforce in the work field should have, and this is another huge topic of discussion here, because the companies and the institutions usually complain about the lack of day-to-day job performing skills rather than the professional ones, you know.
Yeah, that's what we call the horizontal skills that you need. It's more a matter of behavior, problem solving capacities and all
communication.
This. Communication, all language skills. Of course, they are more and more important in all jobs, but I'm sure that you need them also here in Romania, not only in European institutions. You need them everywhere. This is it's becoming, yes, more and more, it's becoming part of what we call skilled people. Right. Also, the attitude towards your work, good motivation, of course, all this is very important. But again, also here in Romania, yeah.
All right, thank you. Waiting for more questions from the public. We'll have another one from Slido. What are the actual steps that the European Union is taking in order to deal with the high rate of unemployment within the youth population of Europe right now? So it's about youth unemployment.
Yeah. Youth unemployment if we talk about unemployment, then of course our heart in the policy is most open to solve the problem of youth unemployment. and also for people with long-term unemployment and specific groups that have difficulties to come into the labor market. But youth unemployment was a huge issue because when we started this mandate 3 years ago, we had a figure on average in Europe of youth unemployment above 20%. Now I'm happy to see that every month it's going down, also here in Romania. Youth unemployment rate in Europe at this moment is at 16%, six, and I think in Romania it's about the same level. So you are on average. But this is not enough. You cannot be happy with 16% of those people that want to work at that age looking for a job and not finding a job. So we have to do more. What we do and what we continue to do is we developed the youth guarantee, supported with the Youth Employment Initiative, that is a dedicated fund. To do what? To have structural reforms in member states, to reform the public employment services. What we asked member states to do is that they register all the people, the young people, that have no employment. And that when people, young people, leave the school or lose a job, that within a period of 4 months, they can get an offer of a traineeship, an apprenticeship, a new educational path, or a job. And this is a kind of structural reforms that we want to happen in member states. Of course, reform has a price, so we support in the member states with the highest level of levels of unemployment. We supported this with the Youth Employment Initiative. That was a budget worth 6.4 billion euro across Europe. And what we did was, because we saw that the problem was very acute in 14 and 15, we said we cannot just use the money we have available over a period of 7 years, because we work with 7 years budgetary, 7 years budget. We cannot wait and say, yeah, 1/7 now, the next 7th part of the budget in 2015, and we go on until 2020. This is too long. We need a solution now. So we front-loaded all the money to the first 2 years. Now this is over, and we claimed new money. We claimed and we obtained fresh money out of the European budget to continue to stimulate member states to do the reform. We also asked Romania to do reform. We have our European Social Fund that is also supportive to do the reforms in the public employment service here in Romania, to professionalize it, to really build up capacity, to have qualified staff, staff with good experience that work on a really professional base to offer those services also to the young people here in Romania. So this is ongoing work. We have not said, ah, oh, we are happy with the 16% young unemployed. Now we are doing better and the rest, it will come spontaneously. No, we continue with the budgetary support. We continue with looking at the performances of member states in this. And every year when we make reports about performances of member states, for every member state, we look at youth unemployment. But let's be happy that it is improving, but we have to continue on this. And has been said before, not only of the side of skills and offers and a good labor market policy and good labor market services. Of course, we also have to build on the other side, makes more job available. So job creation, creating the right environment for entrepreneurs to invest, to innovate, to be competitive, and to be able to create jobs, because most of the jobs, of course, are created in the private sector.
Thank you. We are nearing the end of this conversation, and before asking Commissioner Tyson to give us the closing words and inviting you nearby for more questions and refreshments, may I remind you to vote for the second question, and that is, when you hear the words European Union, what comes to mind first? And possible answers could be open, unity, freedom, whatever else. So you'll see the example on Slido as well. Please vote. This is an active poll. Right there, you see the words shown as an example. All right, so Commissioner Tyson, a few closing words. And once again, given the young audience here, maybe one message for those voting for the first time in an European election in 2 years' time.
To give advice for the elections in 2 years' time? Yeah. Well, I think what I always say when you have elections, first go and vote. You have this right as a citizen, and please use it, because there you appoint the people that are, among others, taking decisions also about your future. So that is very important, to participate in the system, to follow up what's going on, and then give your vote to those people you trust. I always say to young people, look a little bit around and think, when we are doing very badly, when we have big problems, whom should I trust to take decisions to improve the situation? That is what you have to take in mind when you make a choice, when you go to elections. And then, very important to participate in all elections, but also in European elections, because we have so many problems or challenges that we face together. And we have many things on which we can find better solutions if we have exchange of practices and if we decide together. Our competitiveness, our research, universities also, by working together, by speaking with each other, by having member states deciding together, we can have a lot of added value for the citizens in every member state. So don't ignore the European level, the European political level. And then, if I see this, it's still...
Unity and future.
It's Vitor, yeah. It's future?
It's future, yeah, Vitor.
Well, I think then you just understand it all. I think what we have to be... The European project, it started as a peace project. So we have now this nice exhibit here in the university where we say 60 years of European Union. I know it was not 60 years for all the member states, but finally we are reunited. We are one European Union with 27, 28 member states, and some are invited to join us in the future. So this unity, this political stability, this continent of peace, we have to continue to work on that. Therefore, we need European institutions. If we talk about our economic future, about the welfare systems also, our economic future, in a globalized economy and a globalized work, also there we can be stronger together, have better solutions, and defend our values and our preferences, defend our way of life, defend the way we want to shape our future better when we do it together than every member state alone. I think it was Jean-Claude Juncker who once said, you have small member states, and then you have the member states that don't realize yet that they are not big anymore. No member state in Europe, even the biggest one like Germany, can do it alone. So let's work together. And if I see then Unitate and Vitor,
Vitor. Yeah, that's
right. I think these are the most essential words for the European Union. So continue together with us to fight for that. It's important. It's about your future. Thank you very much.
Commissioner Tyson, thank you so much. Thank you to all of you taking part in this citizen dialogue. May I remind my colleagues from the press that they could ask some questions nearby, and you're all invited nearby for a little chat. Thank you very much once again. Thank you.
Thank you.